Back to me. Yes, we have taken it back because a woman of magnificence has joined me in studio. You're very, very welcome, Joanne Callan, from Destination Wellbeing.
Indeed.
How are you?
I'm good, thank you.
Right. I should tell the people if we had... I hope you don't mind me doing this.
Not at all.
Because I'd recommend this to you, and you can tell them where they can do it.
Yeah.
Because this is about well-being. Joanne comes in here, and she is a forest of fragrance. Absolutely beautiful.
Yeah.
And what is it this morning you're wearing?
This morning is a Neil Jard rose and geranium perfume.
Wow.
So it's a commercial perfume, but made only with natural fragrance.
Wow.
There's no synthetic fragrance in it.
What do you think? And what do you think mine is?
I think we've got soap.
Soap, right. What colour of soap? Red soap. Carbolic soap of years ago.
Yes.
75 pence a bar over in McParland's. It's the sort of stuff we used to scrub the doorstep
that's
with and all of that.
So many uses.
Okay. Joanne, Destination Wellbeing today, what are you doing?
We are talking about sound and the healing benefits of sound.
Sound?
Yes.
And what kind of sound? Are we talking about singing bowls
Bowls, healing bowls, both Tibetan singing bowls and crystal bowls. And
what is the difference between a Tibetan singing bowl and a crystal bowl?
The material that it's
so
made
the,
from.
Is the crystal, it's is, a kind of a ceramic thing?
Yes, that's that idea.
Is there a difference in sound?
Yes, the vibrational quality of crystal is obviously much sharper.
Although
the sound as it echoes, you know, as it's driven, as it's played, does deepen and change. But the actual vibration that it creates within the individual that instigates healing is they're all very different. And then we've got some other percussion instruments and different.
Wow. Didgeridoo? No, not quite.
Rain sticks and.
Rain sticks are love. You know, you turn the rain sticks.
It's a beautiful sound. And so simply, you know, they look so simple.
They do. They're simple indeed.
But so that's today's program. And just we'll generally chat about how sound and is so important for healing.
Yeah, and the bowl is taking to your various chakra points.
Yes.
You didn't think I knew that.
There you go. Yes, it's played, well, it depends because you can have an individual sound healing session or a group sound bath. And the group sound bath would be where the instruments would be played in a room. So there may be a number of people there. And generally you find that everybody will experience it differently. So the sound will generally resonate where it needs to.
Yeah.
And where the body needs to release and let go of whatever stuff.
About 15 years ago, I did a nationwide on this for RTE. And I was lying on a floor and a woman was kneeling beside me with the bowls. She had various bowls. Yeah. And she went my head, my solar plexus, my pelvic area, my knees. And the bowls were going, it was the most lovely experience.
It's very therapeutic,
And you close your eyes and you let yourself go, you know.
It's a very deep, we can get into a very deep meditative state.
It takes you there.
It lets you go there.
Yeah.
And then drums and things as well. And there's lots of different instruments
I once knew somebody who was involved in drumming, and mad drumming, drumming. This apparently took the person to another plane or whatever.
The shamanic.
Shamanic drumming. Yes.
Yes, and but there's a chain of thought that would suggest that every woman should have a drum, because it's the, or every person, it's the sound of the heartbeat, the drum of and the womb. It's the sound.
I show you now. This is an interesting thing we were talking here. It's just coincidental. I have this here. And there's some rough images. They're black and white images from my book, and these are in full color. These are my people in the north of a strange place. But if you can see, this drummer here, this is a drum, you see?
Yes.
They're the African people.
Yeah.
They're dancing, they're drumming.
There's something very...
And the other, there's more drums, you see? There's this emphasis on drum, and drum, and drum again, and parade. So it's an amazing sort of, right through mankind and the various.
But it's a very primal sound.
Boom,
the drum,
boom,
the, yeah, boom, that's very. So that's
primal,
our program today.
Primal sound.
Yeah.
Do you drum at all?
I have not for any sign, not for anybody else's ears, possibly, but not one that you might say is nice sound. But I have done some drumming.
Yes. And what kind of drum did you use?
But probably similar to a boron type drum.
Oh yeah, which is nice.
Softer sound of a drum, but it was through a shamanic healing.
Yeah. Where do you think your journey is taking you? Because we've been talking together for a year now, near enough. Yeah. And you've been telling the stories of your various expeditions into healing. Mm-hmm. I sense that you're well through a chapter.
Yes.
Is that a silly thing to be saying?
No, I would like to think that that's there. I think we all go through phases in life, and we all go through, and I also believe that, you know, in the principle of physician, heal thyself. So I think before I can work and sort of help other people, that it's a good idea to start working on sort of my own stuff. That sometimes we, you know, people have said to me, but what are you healing, or what are you, you know, we don't always need to know. And
no,
I don't think
no.
we always know, but I do believe that we carry stuff, not just our own stuff through life, but possibly some ancestral stuff and things that we've taken on, limited beliefs or experiences that people have had that have shaped who we are. And in order to get back to sort of the white, the blank canvas, we need to shed off that stuff. So
do people exude messages of attitude and messages of well-being or not well-being? Can you detect that in what you observe in people?
Well, yeah, very much so. And
or do we disguise?
People can be very good at disguising it, and then some people think they're very good at disguising it, and then you maybe get in touch with their feet through reflexology. Obviously, you can pick up different imbalances, and often you maybe touch on something, and then people realise that that's maybe when the floodgates open, and they're able to.
You see, I think
in a positive sense.
Yeah,
it's always about, we need to get things off our chest, and we bury such generally a lot of us, we bury stuff, and we don't even realise we've buried stuff from.
I think I'm really lucky. I really accept my luck, because there's absolutely nothing that I want to get off my chest. There's absolutely nothing that fazes me. I'm totally chilled. Well, or am I bluffing?
Well, who knows? We can. I mean, it really depends. But if a person feels happy and content in themselves, then there's no, you know, you're not there looking for stuff that isn't there.
No.
So there's no. But if a person feels content and happy, then I would say, you know, you have to go with that. We usually know when there's something that we need to release and let go of.
You didn't start the chapter last week or last month. Can you remember the time that you started to feel that you had
work to do?
Yeah, and that you'd been gifted as a conduit in some way. Were you a wee girl at school?
Was I as young as that? I remember my first experience of using essential oils was doing my 11 plus, which I did when I was 10. So that goes back 23 years. And I didn't drink and I didn't smoke throughout. So and would have always been pretty good with what I ate and different things like that. So I suppose there probably is a sense of it being a life path and a journey that I was meant to do, because I never... People now think, and I don't drink tea or coffee or anything, and people
really?
Now who meet me think that that was a conscious decision, or that was a decision that I made in life, you know, to be healthier.
Yes.
But it was never conscious. It just kind of was the way it went.
Yes.
So I remember that. I remember I first did a journey process when I was 25, and that's by a book by a lady called Brandon Baez, and the journey is an emotional healing practice or experience. So when I did that at 25, I remember the lady that I did it with was in her mid-60s maybe at the time.
Wow.
And she said to me, and there's a few interviews with Kit on the previous Destination Wellbeing, but what Kit said to me at the time was, I only wish I'd known at 25 what you now know, and life would have been very different.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Or may have been different, or my experience of life would have been different. So that, I suppose, maybe resonated with me, and that possibly led to work with children as well, because I thought, well, you know, imagine if we can take these skills on at 25, And they can make such a big difference. Imagine if we were to take some of them on five or six or whatever.
Yeah. You're going to be a happy person.
That would make. Well, you're going to, I think for me, the thing is that life happens and things happen, you know, life, just because you choose a particular path doesn't mean that life has always been smooth and always been easy, because that's not usually the case. But what I do think it has given me is possibly a resilience within myself. Now, there's times when that hasn't been as strong and different things like that, and we always get challenged. But generally speaking, so that my personal choice was never to rely on alcohol or drugs or cigarettes or tea or coffee or, I suppose, stimulants or even prescribed medication. It was about finding inside me how I could figure things
out. You're a clever person.
So, so who knows? That was... So I don't remember a particular moment, but I think it has been a journey. As you said, the chapter didn't start last week.
No. I can see this in you.
Been an ongoing, possibly a lifetime journey.
Why is it there's a gink in my mind, a kind of a, you know, there's a glitch in my mind. I love your fragrance, your essential oils, but yet I would be afraid to use them because I'd be fearful of being regarded as a pink person. But I mean, are there essential oils for men?
Yes, there are more masculine ones.
Well, what should one be looking for?
Generally, sandalwood,
patchouli.
Patchouli.
I would sometimes use patchouli oil, and people say, ugh, I hate that. But whatever.
But, you know, I mean, no matter, smell is such a personal thing. So you will always find people who don't like smell, no matter what the
but
smell
sandalwood.
Is. Sandalwood, orange, the citrusy
orange,
kind of ones.
Yeah. I should be saying, I want these to help me chill.
Yes.
Not to get excited. Because I do tend to get excited sometimes.
Yes.
And
I
do things and say
and then
things.
Flower essences are another one.
Flower essences. Okay.
Are taken internally.
So today it is.
Sound.
Sound. And will we finish by. Well, what time are you on at?
3 p.m. today.
3 p.m. today. Singing bowls and sound of other types. Now we shall do a sound. We'll do a chant.
Our own sound. Okay.
Our own sound to finish this off. And then once I give you the signal, Ryan, there's Ryan Markey, who's our desk man today. He's the studio engineer. Once I give you the signal, then you can bring on the next music. And are we ready?
We're ready.
Ryan, thank you very much
indeed.
God love you. You're a great person. Thank you.